Kia ora tātou, ai mua I te kairiake, I nā kōrero ki nā pae tarā whare, tēnei te tukuatu I nā whakamuemiti ki te wāhinaro, hei whakatupera ke I te āhuatana o tā tātou kaupapa, ai te ahiahi nei, tō reira ke aidoe tātou. Hō nore kōrea he mau nā runa ki te whenua whakaaro pai ki nā tāna ta katoa āne. Mea nātua tātou nā kau ki a ihoa kei reira nei te āwhina mō tātou, no ihoa nei te āwhina mō tātou, no te kaihana o te rani o te whenua. Ko ihoa tō tātou whakamarumaru tana ki tōnari na matau e kore tātou e Pākehā e te rā e te awatea e te maramara nei te pō. Ma ihoa tātou e tia ki roto I nā haere nā atumi nā haere nā mai, ae anei āke tonu atu. Glória ki tō I nā tapu. Āmen.
Tihi Māori ora. Ena mana, ena rau, ena karangatanga maha, tēnā koutou. E aku rangatira, kia tātou e tau nei, ka nui takumihi. Tauhiti mai ki tā tātou hui whakanga, whakanui. Ka nui te honore ki te mihi, kia koutou. Nō reira, tēnā koutou. Tēnā koutou, tēnā koutou katoa. It is my pleasure tonight to extend a very warm welcome to you all, family, friends, students, colleagues, and our wider community, to the inaugural lecture of Professor of Architecture at Te Kura Waihanga, Victoria University of Wellington, Derek Kawiti. For those who don't know me, I'm Rod Barnett, head of the School of Architecture at Te Kura Waihanga. And it's my real pleasure to welcome you here this evening to celebrate Derek's amazing work and his achievements. Professor Kawiti is a renowned expert and teacher in advanced digital tools and robotics, specializing in Māori designed environments and indigenous technologies. Derek first joined Te Herenga Waka in 2013 as senior lecturer in interdisciplinary digital design. He gained his Bachelor of Architecture from the University of Auckland and Master of Architecture from the Architectural Association in the UK. Importantly, Derek is also an architectural practitioner, and he has worked both locally and abroad for many years. He has extensive experience as a cultural strategist and design advisor to major companies in the industry, and is a director of interdisciplinary design firm Silo Arc. He is an associate director at Pettlethorpe Architects as well in Auckland, where he is digital and cultural lead. Derek also serves as a principal investigator for the MacDiarmid Institute, where he's part of the MacDiarmid Science Executive. Derek's academic career is impressive, with an extensive and significant research record. His academic research, teaching, and practice all draw on influences from his cultural heritage, where a central concern is with understanding the implications of the growing use of digital design in architecture and its increasing convergence with aspects of indigenous Māori customary knowledge. His consistent dedication to his research and practice has seen him awarded many professional distinctions and memberships. And he's highly regarded by his students and us, his colleagues, as an excellent teacher and postgraduate supervisor. Derek heads the Site of Indigenous Technologies Understanding Alliance, as well as Indigenous Material Domains and Corporate Spheres, Indigenous Workspaces. These labs play a significant role in the indigenizing of architectural knowledge. Derek has been influential in the development of a new intersection between computational tools and fabrication methods in the relation to customary methods of Māori craft production and design. In his lecture tonight, Professor Kawiti will provide an overview of the research he's been involved with here at the university and its relationship to the development of a Maturanga Māori-driven technological lens. This will be framed by a discussion of Te Ahi Tupua, a recently completed civic arts project that explores the marriage of Māori pattern geometry and digital computational design. The sculpture is a collaboration between Stacey Gordine of the New Zealand Māori Arts and Crafts Institute in Rotorua and Derek Kawiti. He discusses tonight the process of design and construction of a project hailed as the largest 3D printed sculpture in the world at the time. Of interest are the challenges facing a traditional manufacturing industry in its shift towards a technologically demanding manufacturing, technical demanding manufacturing, and the drive for industry change due to an increase in design complexity, redefining the limits of art, design, architecture, and engineering. Naku te honore ki te whakatu I ene aharangi, Derek Kawiti. It's my great pleasure to introduce Professor Derek Kawiti to you all tonight.
Ai te tuatahi, ka tū au ki te tuku atu he mihi, a ki te kai karakia, e te mātanga, e te tōhunga, e te whanaunga e tū, nau nei tēnei pō e haka pūrea, tō mihi, tō karakia, tō haka moimiti, i te reo a whakawhetai ki te atua, a tēnei te tino mihi kia koe e tū. A kia koe hoki e Rod, e te kai hautū kura, o te kura hoa hoa whare, nau nei a hau I tēnei pō I haka uru, ki tēnei te kāhui, ki te hunga huihuinga, ko haere mai, ki te tautoko, ki te hakarongo ki ngā kōrero, e whakātū nei a hau I tēnei wā. Nō reira, tēnā koe. Huri nō ki te whare, ngā kānohi tini, ko tai mai, tēnā koutou, tēnā tātou katoa. Kia hopu ake au ki te toki matanui, ko te āwhi o rangi, ko te kuharere mai. Te maramara tupu whai ake nō raro hakahotu nuku, hakahotu rangi, te manawa. As I work with and wield the sacred ads, te toki matanui, chips fly this way and that. Becoming something new, there's nothing superfluous or excessive. There is only life, a new life between earth and sky. It gives me great pleasure to present my inaugural lecture to you all tonight. Great to see so many people, here in particular Acting Vice-Chancellor Rawinia Higgins, te kāhui tāngato te heringa waka, tō tātou whare e moi ana, a te manawa, tēnā koe, a tēnā koutou. Friends and family, colleagues, heads of school, my wife, who pragmatically speaking I would not be here, in front of you today under this air of complete organisation, poise and calmness. there is a well-known whakatauki from my northern iwi, Ngāti Hine, and I say this quite often, ina ka tere he kapua, he hauki muri. We quite often only see the clouds moving across the sky and not what pushes them along. So I'd like to thank the many people that have supported me along the way, and I feel very honoured to be here tonight. Thank you. Unuhea nōtea te taniwha I te rua. Your kind support has also, at the very least, forced me, this taniwha, to come out of my research cave, which is literally a windowless back room, which I am grateful for, in the School of Architecture, Te Aro campus on Vivian Street. A back room which has seen much activity over the last 8 years or so, and has seen many great students and collaborators and friends come and go. My talk tonight will cover some of this activity. Hopefully the research work I present to you will illustrate my position as a researcher within the rapidly changing profession of architecture. It will also start to elaborate upon my interaction with Māori knowledge to a degree. And while the advertised kaupapa for my talk centred on Te Ahi Tupua, the sculpture project for Hemel Road in Rotorua, the talk instead will discuss a selection of projects to set the research tone leading into the sculpture discussion, with the aim of showing how the sculpture is positioned within the diverse ways in which Māori knowledge and attitudes, including customary material practices, might inform, influence, and drive culturally rich architectural research and engineering disciplines. It has taken many years to undo, to some degree, the strict modernist disciplinary training and programming I received at the School of Architecture in Auckland as an undergraduate student. Looking back, the notion of the universal, the standard, and the eternal is hard to ignore, almost as much as the bow ties and round spectacles. Although black suits and black clothing are in fact different, if anything, I'm now grateful for this institutional erasure, my own voluntary amnesia, as a catalyst for a renewed zeal for the prospect of regaining, to some extent, Indigenous architectural knowledge. My continuous use of computers in architecture has always been a priority, if not a frustration to those who know me. In some respects, yet it is not difficult to understand that it is almost a crime to undertake modernist architecture using computers. Over the years, I've come to the realization that the best use of computers and their somewhat seemingly endless capacity and capability in architecture is when you're breaking the rules. Complex processes, exuberant formal typologies are the thing that these tools do best. And in the words of many long-standing computer-based designers in architecture, of which I am one, it is only now that because of computers that the vast complexity and contradictions in the world can be reframed, re-represented and harnessed. Much to the despair of my students, generative and computational design methods and thinking is not straightforward. It requires not only an open mind, but an understanding of the complex ontological frameworks of authorship that exist within these seemingly innocuous tools. Coupled with this is the added challenge of the ongoing convergence or bringing together of Māori customary concepts through digitization. And in the context of my research, rapid prototyping, automation, and robotic manufacturing. For me personally, much of the challenge is how we understand its system of effects and implications on Indigenous cultural practices and tikanga. What is replaced? What is lost? What does this new authorship mean? And what is redefined and reframed? In the summer of 2014, with the strong support of Richard Brooking, the then CE of Ngaitā Manuhiri, and iwi project manager Jody Tōroa, Situa was conceived of and set up in a small wool shed in the village of Muriwai, 30 kilometres south of Gisborne. The lab was set up with a view to support kaupapa a iwi, iwi research. Research with selected iwi partners who were interested in working with students to explore kaupapa that consisted of materials research within a specific iwi domain, what they understood to be mātauranga Māori and technology. In Situa, site of Indigenous Technologies Understanding Alliance, students are expected to work outside of the university in order to deal with a heightened sense of context, people and place. Situa now exists wholly within the institution. I'd like to take you through a series of projects. This is a fairly old project that came, one of the first projects that came out of Situa, where we looked at the principles of spatial organisation derived by Māori urban status of diaspora, where the project utilises scripted multi-agent systems, a computational framework that mimics collective biological organisation found in swarms, flocks and schools. The code produced took into account a minimal size three-dimensional cell or spatial envelope that was then scripted with behaviours in line with urban status categories referenced from Anaruwa's research on the various geospatial categories for Māori in mainly urban environments. Mana whenua, ahi kā, mā tāwaka, tūnga hō, and taurahere. These categories describe relationships and connections to place and territories and denote degrees of connection to iwi, hapu, and cultural identity. The algorithm was then used to structure proximities between agents using tribal biases and general stereotypical behaviours that we use to hypothetically create a spatial organisation for an urban papakāinga. Further criteria such as orientation of apartments, income, family type, access to amenity, and proximity in relation to these tribal differences were explored. The project was a precursor to the creation of complex communities that use computational modelling and simulation as a tool for design, where the editor designs, controls, and controls the hierarchy of criteria explicitly. The next project I'd like to show you was undertaken with some master students, namely Mark Bagley, who is still currently in the School of Design, Noah Orr of the Architecture School. With this project, we were looking at understanding the relationship between biological matter and biological matter and agents. The central problem that we're interested in solving at the time was collapse in high filigree print structures. The project started through the framing of a certain principle for design that had an inverted hierarchy to it. The central premise was the acknowledgement of relationships between the act of making taonga puoro and the orchestration of tōtorongu, which are caterpillars or grubs. In this project, we looked at how through Māori history, tōtorongu were held up as a prized insect that would aid in the excavation and production of taonga puoro, or Māori musical instruments, by hollowing the pith of trees and plants. The idea that these tōtorongu, these biological agents, could somehow be part of the tooling process started to align with the understanding that within Māori knowledge frameworks, there was a connection through whakapapa that moves across species and animal worlds. Through attempting to solve the problem of collapse in clay, for high filigree clay structures, we came up with a double extruder. So the principle of the research was to take on the principle of whakairo. Whakairo means to carve, iro, as a suffix to the word whakairo. Whakairo is a maggot or a grub. And so we were interested in understanding how we could utilise the tooling or the organic nature of the tōtorongu to help us to excavate an outer casing that held together an internal high filigree clay geometry. So you can see here in the image the double extruder that we produced. Also to the right of the page are some of the tool paths where we could orchestrate the laying down of food, of cellulose for the tōtorongu or fair, to excavate the encased high filigree object. So in this case, we're wanting to look at how fairly low technologically derived biological systems could help us to solve high technology problems with 3D printing. Excuse me for that last page. I've managed to mix up the order of my pages. And so where you have especially a high filigree and also viscous model of complex geometry, to avoid collapse, we looked at encasing it with an outer casing of material that the tōtorongu or fair would excavate and retard the drying process and help us to control how the internal structure was supported. The next project is quite a dear one to my heart as well, and involves many students who I've worked with in the past, namely Guy Newton, Jason McChalse, Sam Alexander, and that is looking at the architectural forensic heritage. And while there is not a lot of information and documentation for the architecture and engineering of the Hakari stage in particular, it appeared at a very specific time in the history of the country and were almost exclusively recorded in the Taitokero northern region. The work that we've touched on relates to the long Hakari stage from the Bay of Islands, and in particular Ngāti Manu, in the Kororare Kakaretu area. Our work has consisted of deriving forensically its modulus and principles of proportion and structure from written accounts. That we've then applied this to the construction of visual scripts and algorithms. Many of these models that you see here were some of the initial studies into the research or forensic heritage of the Hakari stage in particular. A main focus for us is the regaining of these structures and architectures, not only of Hakari, but also Tirewa, Pa'aurua, that you'll find in Taranaki, a Purutuna, that you find in the north, a Pekerangi, Maioro, and many others. Many of these architectural structures did not make it through the colonial gauntlet, or were not durable enough to be brought through to be experienced in our contemporary civic life. So part of what we do with our architectural forensic heritage, or whare hoahoa tukuiho, is to try and re-understand in order to make them part of our ongoing or future civic environments. So there are a key proportions, the takoto, which is a 1.6 module, and it's a person standing upright with a person lying with their arms by their side. And then there is the 2.1, which is a person standing with their arms upstretched. So those were the base proportions and modulus that we used, and then forensically derived from sketches, photographs, images, and accounts. We also, through our algorithmic tutuing, our algorithmic research, we looked at how we might redeploy these within the freedom of the digital environment to understand their complexity, new types of distribution. Here's the project of Guy Newton's, looking to bring a massive monumental Hakari that follows the Avon River in Christchurch in order to be provocative, but to also entice a response of wonder, bemusement, but also to contrast against the ongoing suppression or a lack of knowledge around these very beautiful and very complex engineering structures. Situa's main facilities were based initially, as I discussed before, in Woolshed and Shearer's Quarters close to Ngaitā Manuhiri Village in Muriwai in Gisborne. This is young Nick's head jutting out there, the Gisborne Township, and then the main bay extending around to the town. So 30 kilometres south of Gisborne. With the whānau there, with our iwi partners and researchers, we looked at the setting up of a 3D printer setup. This was some 7-8 years ago, so very much in its rudimentary stages. But through the collaboration, we started to work with looking at how the technology that we brought in might trigger memories around various materials, and in particular clay, which we did a lot of research on. We knew that W.A. Puller was responsible for a report in the 1950s and 1960s on the endemic clays that were found in Gisborne. So through this research, we were able to get out and find bentonite clays, highly absorptive engineering clays, cosmetic clays, and others, and edible clays, a whole range of clays that we're able to work with. With the James Durkin is my main master's student at the time. We built a 3D printer, a collapsible one. We took it to a conference and it was quite popular, especially with the Turkish contingent from Ankara University, who were interested in how it would collapse so they could put it onto the back of a donkey. And so we're starting to work with how we could build our own mobile technologies. This was built from a wheelchair motor with a PVC drum and a worm screw ram, which were fashioned together in the back room, partly at Victoria University and partly at James's house and partly in the Ngaita Manuhiri domain as well. I've got a longish kind of film animation here, I'll quickly play it. I might skip through parts of it as well. Through this work, we had a lot of interaction with Ngaita Manuhiri, with the local school, participating in the production of clay, as you can see here. It's quite an extensive process, but we were using clays endemic to those places. A lot of the impact that this research had was the whānau there, who started off as research partners, started to fully lead the process in terms of remembering that they used clays for cooking, used clays for wrapping tuna and for cooking. And so encasing food in clay and putting it on the fire and then breaking it off. And so all of these old practices and traditions around clays started to re-emerge in that particular community. So it's a very scientific process. This was our first prototype, and we found that working with Māori, that actually the whānau there knew more about how we could improve and innovate the machine, how we could create different types of dampers to help us to extrude clay more effectively than the motor we had. So there were all sorts of outputs and impacts, I guess, that came from that exchange. Most importantly, I think, was getting the students out of the university. Placing them with iwi was a totally different and surprising experience for them. But it was quite funny. I dropped off one particular student, and after 2 weeks I came back, and he was washing dishes at the wharehui while there was a hui on, had become one of the whānau. So he worked his way, literally how you normally do, and went on a fast track though, because they wanted him to do some work. From the kitchen out the back and to some of the research at the front. We did a whole lot of firing, raku pit firing as well. And there's part of the setup in the wool shed. This project is I guess version 2 of the process of clay printing, robotic clay printing in particular, where we've started to look at using more sophisticated tools, using a digitally driven, a CNC driven clay extruder. This project was undertaken with students Angus Horn, and with the aid of Alan Wihungi, the master carver, Bernard Makware as well. So some very, very experienced northern based Tohunga Whakairo carvers who supplied us a lot of the patterns and templates that we were then to start working with clays in order to shift what they thought was good, in order to shift some of the carving focus on renewable materials into clays and widely available materials located in some of these communities. So we worked with Tohunga Alan Wihungi. And so it was a very extensive digitization process. So every time we undertake some of this research, we improve and we innovate some of our processes. To start with, we created some very destructive geometries, as you can see with the one with Angus next to it, and then Max. we produced some very destructive digital modelling. And so what that meant was that we weren't able to fully drive through the design intent of the carvers as a type of replication or duplication of what they intended the carving to be. So it was we found a limitation in the software that we had. So between Angus and Max was a space of 2 years. And so we finally have algorithms that can reproduce or replicate to a very high detailed degree, carving detail from carvers, and also preserve some of the signatures associated with that as well. So we're quite proud of that project, even though the smaller gains take a lot of work, nevertheless they're worthwhile. And so here's the extruder, building one of the first Po, and then we assembled it on a building in the far north, a building that's run by myself, a building that was designed in our practice, my wife and I's practice, Siloak, went over a series of some 8 or 9 years for the from conception to building, and it went through resource consent for 6 years, so it took a long time to be approved and come out of that, but we persevered. And so in that time, the technology changed so greatly that we were able to then install some carvings onto their particular whare. So some of the first 3D printed clay carvings as a central Po. And so I'm getting to the end of my showcasing these different projects, but I wanted to show you this project. It's very important, I think, and it was a project that we worked together on with Ngāti Tūkorehe, who are based in Oho, north of here, northwest of here, towards Ōtaki, beyond Ōtaki, sorry. We worked with high-pressure ground grout injection methods. It was a method that I brought to Situa through some of my experience in the UK, where we were responsible for the refurbishment of a 150-year-old villa on the bank of the Thames, which was subsiding. And we used high-pressure grouting to lift the whole building that was built on shingle and loose material. And so from that, I was really wanting to see what we might do with this particular technique. And so working with Huhana Smith and Ngāti Tūkorehe here in Oho, we looked at how we might use this to produce subterranean excavatable structures. And so we also were looking at it in the way that it had been used, that I had been exposed to in the UK using bentonite injection clays, and how they were able to create efficiencies within low-performing and porous soils, shoring up subterranean waterproofing, tanking and underpinning foundations. And so it was really, we were really excited to start this project. But what we wanted to explore instead was the actual physics of what was going on with the particular method. But we wanted to understand the physics in relation to a Māori knowledge principle. So we were looking at this idea that we would inject into the soil, much like a tree root structure, create novel foundations, high strength foundations, but also think about this idea of atua. Thinking about atua, trying to open up new potentials for a really mundane technical process, i.e. high pressure ground grouting in a way. And so using controlled injection and pultrusion to create these subterranean freeform structures, the idea of atua was around the forces and energies that we don't see or experience in a non-abstract form. So energies and forces that act on matter that are in some ways intangible or at least undetectable. Ground forces, ground structures, but looking at the very different compartments of atua and how we might reconceptualize them in our design. So looking at how we might harness those the forces of upward pressure, lateral pressure across soils and different clay structures, and how we might be able to orchestrate different effects and orchestrate these novel structures through that. So we did a lot of material analysis, and we also did a lot of simulation, how we might try and engineer these novel structures that would be once injected into the ground from primarily different compounds and mixes of concrete, you could excavate them as freeform structures or use them to shore up erosion-prone shoreline and coastal areas, which was one of the key collaborations with the Oho Whānau, was how to shore up those coastal edges that were being highly eroded. Out of interest, the area at Oho represents some of the fastest moving geologies in the country, something like 200 millimetres over 500 years, which is very fast, apparently. But these techniques help to input into very real problems of shoring up those baseline areas of coastal eroded edges. And so some of the initial 3D printing prototypes using a method of soft and hard forming. The soft forming was inside of a 1x1x1 meter encasement of a mix of clay and sand, where we put in an injector and we pultruded to create these structures. So a lot of time and energy went into some of the rudimentary things, and also building machines to help us to understand it more and more. So how we orchestrate and use and be part of how atua form and influence our material environments. So a very abstract definition of atua, I guess. Another one is a project that I wasn't going to show tonight, but I will. But it was a project that hasn't really kicked off yet, but it surrounds trying to solve the problem of rolling and tumbling in satellites. And so through this, we're investigating how the taurapa, which is an inverted wing keel, an air keel, how the taurapa, through its high filigree surfacing and carving, creates turbulence and drag in order to stabilize the waka. There are some collaborators that we started putting a team together with that believe that it may help to solve tumbling and the loss of signals with satellites. So that's quite an exciting project and coming up soon through our collaboration with experts Hemi Erawera up in Ruawhetū in Northland and others with waka. So some of the initial analyses I did with a student, Max Clifford. One of my last projects before I get to the sculpture project is another very special project that I worked on with New Zealand Māori Arts and Crafts Institute. It was for the refurbishment and re-establishment of the Te Ahi Soldiers Memorial, which is close to town and is around a small roundabout. The story behind it is that with the Te Ahi Soldiers Memorial was that in the early 80s, two of them were damaged beyond repair. Two of them were all, those particular two went missing. And so nobody had any records of photographic records or slides. We had an amnesty for the project for people to bring out their slides and to delve into what they might have in terms of their photographic records. And we weren't able to find any record of these two particular carvings that were missing of the eight. So the eight beating hearts of Te Ahi. And so we looked at how we might build an algorithm, and I did this with Catherine Campbell Hunt, one of my ex-students, who's very, very, very bright, amazing student, built an algorithm to use the six that we knew of, the six that we had from our scans, and we used them to breed the most likely final pair of carvings. Then we 3D printed them and cast them in bronze, and this was a widely publicised project. But we bred 15 different po, and then we chose two from that final 15. So that was quite an amazing project, but it starts to delve into principles of whakapapa, so and parentage and offspring within a digital environment. And so what we're looking at doing was to try and understand the geometrical, mathematical DNA of some of the geometries that we'd built in the computer, some of the geometries that were incredibly complex, in order to then use them to breed and pass on that DNA to the most likely pair of Po that were then used. So quite an exciting project as well. So as you're starting to gather, I'm very much into computational environments and computational thinking, and in particular, thinking around how a Māori lens might reinterpret or open up the space of exploration. So leading into the sculpture discussion, and I have a small film, and this was taken at the installation of the project in Rotorua. It is a sculpture, it's not, you know, within my overall scope as an architect, but it posed some very, very complex problems for us, not only in its installation, it took 2 days to install because of its fabrication, but in terms of its opening up the space of conservatism that exists in the profession of in the manufacturing industry, meaning that a lot of the what we had as a design and its very, very complex geometries were quite challenging and posed a risk to our fabricator, our contractor, who produced the sculpture in the end. It took 4 years in total to go from concept design, where I worked with a really well-known designer, Stacey Gordine, at New Zealand Arts and Crafts Institute, Māori Arts and Crafts Institute, NZ Mackey. We were toing and fro for at least a year with designs. He came to me initially to see how his design, which he thought was way too complex to build, could be built. Part of that was learning about understanding the limits and the limits and risks posed in the manufacturing industry around what could be and could not be produced. So initially we had tenderers through the procurement phase looking at how we might adopt stainless steel 316, the strongest stainless steel, but they didn't like the crazy curvature, all of the interpolated curves and the really complicated geometries. So they wanted us to pare it back and dumb it down in a way. So we had to go through a process that you normally get through industry anyway, but a process that normally, because of degrees of complexity, is not that long and drawn out or tense and hard fought. We fought to maintain the complexity and sophistication of the geometry for the sculpture, and we're only able to do that through our use of computers and to prove that it could be built. But stainless steel, with going down the stainless steel path, which was recommended by all of the tenderers that we dealt with and one of the main contractors in the end, was totally unfeasible. And this is internationally. We went to Italy, we went to Germany, we went to Switzerland. The Italians were the front runners and had worked with complex doubly curved, interpolated curves before in their CNC mandrels, the things that they used to pipe bend, basically. We even went to Toyota, who do roll bars for big SUVs. None of them could get around the problem of material stretch and material rigidity and brittleness, just through to the because of the metal composition of stainless steel. And so the high chromium posed risks of shattering and breaking. And so we were at running the risk of slowing down and then maybe giving up and ditching the project. At the same time, we also were exposed to a lot of public and civic grief in a way that didn't want the project to go ahead, saw it as a very expensive folly. And so we were battling that as well. I remember carrying that the model that we're going to do some press release stuff on to on the plane, and the awful glares I got sort of getting onto the plane, because everybody knew on the Rotorua flight what was happening, and they'd seen it publicised in some really negative media. So in that initial video, when you see it coming in with a Black Hawk helicopter, which was pretty amazing, there was still a lot of protest and anguish over it. But we were locked into a process of delivering this thing, and we're locked into a process of trying to forge new ground and using Māori geometries and mathematics to do it. And it was just through our perseverance with some of the initial techniques of analysis, and by the way, the sculpture is derived from a takarangi, and so a double helix or a double spiral, but also the takarangi was chosen by Stacey with the area that I'm hovering over here, Te Puke Te Ruahine, is a really famous geyser outflow area. They put cameras down into the geyser before it erupted prior to the project, or prior to the design project, and found that before it would erupt, it would spiral and then come out like a reverse kind of water flow exiting a plug. So it was quite, that was the inspiration for it, but it was also the deployment of some, you know, in a way, some fairly standard Māori geometries. Through our work and analysis on these Māori geometries, we found that they were quite heavily optimized, and if not optimized already, highly optimizable. So we could, through our algorithms, run analyses to structurally verify that these structures would work. Here are some of the kaupapa corridor pieces that were installed onto the sculpture in the end. These are some of the initial screenshots of some of the long hours work that we did on all of the analysis and all of the structural testing. Some of the diagrams on the right show with a 10 millimeter deflection under particular wind loads. So we did a lot of this work ourselves because we didn't want to give the project up. We were convinced it would work. We had this idea that Māori geometries are inherently as a pattern of system of pattern, inherently have inherently are able to diagrammatically form the path of structural loadings, and so we use a lot of the Māori design language to support that as we went along. So we didn't take away, we only took away what was not compliant to that. So we did a lot of this research, and we did it very quickly in the end, in comparison to how the engineers approached it. The engineers took so long to structurally test, verify, and do all the calculations for it. We went through two engineers, Opus, and then but we had Gurit in the end, who almost they got fed up as well. But we had this model that we knew worked. And then we had 50 pages of engineering sketches and calculations that were that came into play to verify what we're talking about. So when the engineering drawings came through and the engineering verification came through, nobody said anything to see if we would notice. But we were really happy because we knew it would work. But we did cop a lot of flack. So a lot of that also was how to break up the files. So while there was a lot of shopfront design glory, there's a lot of back of house work in technically delivering it. And I think that was a real big learning curve in terms of how to corral very risk adverse contractors. We had Kilwell to persevere and keep moving the project ahead, especially in light of there were rising costs, but not substantially or significantly. But they were going into unknown territory. So Kilwell traditionally produce long linear rods, and they thought that this would be just another derivation of that, but little did they know the full-on complexity when you're trying to build something so long, 12 metres high, out of smaller bits. So they bought eight Alpha Rise 3D printers, and they used a PLA, a polylactic print material, sorry for the technical language, a cornstarch filament, but an organic filament that was used to produce each of these runs of the print. I have a sample just to show you the thickness and the size of each piece. So there were over 700 bits to the sculpture, They all have a unique kiwi, a male, female kiwi, so you can't really miss assemble it. So it was really great seeing a lot of that come on. Media had to be contained as well, so it was a very, very exciting yet tense project. And so some of the shots before we were moving on site for it to be assembled. At this stage, we were in the final throes of checking and looking for quality assurance of how things were put together and how they were finished. And so we had battles right to the end to argue for a better, more focused contractor to finish their work and to finish their work with much more care. So we had tension the whole way through. But the final structure we're very proud of. From this, New Zealand Māori Arts and Crafts have roped me into a few other things, but it's they're really interested in what happens when patterns are abstracted from their traditional materials, i.e. timber. So what can you do with these things? How big can they get at scale? How, when they move from very constraining materials such as timber, although timber has very efficient grain systems of structural loading, how can they move into new frontiers of material production? So very, very exciting project in that respect. And a few smiles from some of the Rotorua locals as well, because I think it's, and I'm not sure of the current acceptance of the sculpture, and but I do still get sideways looks when I say that I was part of the production team for it, but I think they do appreciate it. And so part of the deeper learnings from the sculpture is how Māori geometries have latent, or Māori patterns have latent performative aspects, and sometimes we get caught up on how things look. And so, to summarise, and it is important to summarise, as industry science and indeed the education of our students shapes our world, we have no choice as Indigenous peoples to shape it back. And however rudimentary and crude some of these research projects may seem, they at this point in time define and attempt to hold a line, albeit an imperfect one. As architects and designers, we can no longer just be concerned with surface articulation and surface appearances in a disconnected and discrete way. This, dare I say it, may be seen to be an abuse of Māori knowledge. We have to forego the habitual preoccupation with surface to return to the interior nature of surface, our interior, to the implicit space of design where meanings, cultural or otherwise, are deeply linked and reinforced by performance and connection to our environments and peoples. Where cultural ideas resonate through action and activation, not borrowed theory and lip service, it is clear that we can no longer ignore the world of materials, people and nature. The psychology of design has to change for the smarter. The design of the built environment should not be limited to vernacular styles and shapes alone, but should extend to the suppressed disciplines of material knowledge and craft. Technology, while ever changing and developing in shorter cycles to fatiguing levels, requires other ontological biases to offset a seemingly inevitable predetermined end. We've well and truly entered into the age of Te Ahi Tupua, the swirling tumultuous sky. And while my talk attempts to align with atua as a knowledge distinction for Māori, it calls to mind my tupuna, Te Kawiti, often referred to as the pagan chief, and his understanding and alignment with atua. I would like to leave you with a final thought. It is not my own, but was uttered some 177 years ago by my ancestor, who during the Battle of Ruapekapeka in the Bay of Islands and under great adversity proclaimed in his takuate or lament, "E koreau e mutu I te tū ki rote te pakanga kia kairano hau te rereu te pō kātahi ono. Hau ka tū ki te pakanga ka hinga hoki rā te wānui o tāne e takoto nei e takoto nei." He had a true love for his people and for the world and the earth, a love that we may never know, a love with no concept of the individual, only of the collective, and in a time of great upheaval and irreversible change, a change not unlike what we are all facing now in these uncertain and unprecedented times. He says, I will not stop fighting until the driving sleet of death tears the flesh from my bones, for I am in the world. I will not cease until the last great tree of Tāne has fallen. Thank you all again for coming tonight. It's very humbling. Tēnā tātou.
Ngāti hine, ngā puhi, ngāti porou, te waimana kākū. I ngā mātā waka o te motu, tēnā koutou, kua tai mai ki tēnei kauhau a ahorangi Derek Kawiti. Nōku te maringa nui ki te tautoko i ngā mihi ki a koutou tuatahi. Tuarua ki te mihi ki te kai kōrero o te pō a ahorangi Derek Kawiti o te kura waihanga, o te wāhanga, waihanga hoahoa o te herenga waka. Nō reira, kei aku nui, kei aku rahi, kei aku whakatamarahi ki te rangi, tēnā koutou katoa. Distinguished guests, my name is Professor Awania Higgins and I am the Deputy Vice-Chancellor of Māori and Engagement and today Acting VC. And it is my privilege to thank Professor Derek Kawiti for his inaugural professorial lecture this evening. These events allow our professors to demonstrate their craft, their insights, their expertise, knowledge, and their scholarship in their disciplinary fields. And as we saw play out this evening, get their nerd on and start talking about the things that they like, they love and their passion, and they go right down in there. And we are just like, smile. And for many of us, like myself, we smile and just go, oh, that sounds cool. I have no idea what he's talking about, but hey, thank goodness for the PowerPoint. Tonight, Professor Kawiti has raised the sacred tuki, or adds te awhi orangi, that he referred to in his mihi and in his summary, and he has figuratively sketched, designed, carved, computated, and presented a visual and intellectual outline of his works. Kua mau te iro. The maggot has set in. And it's a colloquialism for now we have learnt our lesson from Derek, and now we know more of your work. At the professorial dinner earlier this year, I noted that it is of no surprise to the Māori world that Derek is an architect. He is a descendant of the rangatira and signatory of Te Tiriti or Waitangi, Tiruki Kawiti, who was world renowned for his design of the fortified Rua Peka Peka Pā. His tipuna's designs were not only admired, but adopted by other military experts around the world. Like his tipuna before him, Derek has gained international recognition for his scholarship. Professor Kawiti is an architect, but his projects are not limited to buildings, as we saw today. What makes his work unique in the range and scope of his research through is the range and scope of his research through his engagement with a wide range of collaborators. Whether it is papakāinga development to clay popo, to hākari stages, to 3D replica of waka, that's housed in the Smithsonian that he didn't talk about but was in the notes that I received, to sculptures replicating DNA or grouting for space rockets, his grounding in mātauranga Māori continues to push the boundaries of knowledge and more specifically how it is applicable to modern technologies and thought processes. Professor Kawiti likened himself to a taniwha hiding in his rua, or cave, at Te Aro, undertaking his research that pulls traditional mātauranga Māori and organic matter and transforms them into modern structures, forms, and applications. Like our historical narratives of rua taniwha, people often approach the cave with some trepidation, awe and fear, as the taniwha is often portrayed as a monster or demon, but they are the kaitiaki of a taonga. Now, Derek might downplay himself as being hidden away in his cave working on his research, But what he produces is not just an output, but a taonga. These taonga, however, are not just reproductions of traditional Māori art forms or modern pieces with Māori motif. His work critically examines and investigates traditional mātauranga Māori designs as a means to understand both form and function. Where most people have often viewed Māori design as ornamental, Professor Kawiti unlocks an epistemology that has been overlooked by Western scholars. While these hegemonic views have often rendered mātauranga Māori as inferior, Neolithic, savage, irrelevant, or just myths and legends, Derek dispels these so-called myths and underscores the mana of the knowledge of our ancestors. Scholarship is all about pushing disciplinary norms, being critical, reflective, and pushing new frontiers of knowledge. We ask this of our professors in these lectures, but like the Taniwha, who is the kaitiaki of taonga or mātauranga, Professor Kawiti underscores our responsibilities as mātauranga holders. When we gain mātauranga, impart mātauranga, redefine mātauranga, or reframe mātauranga, we must be cognizant of the source of that mātauranga, what we replace, and the implications on our tikanga, cultural practices, and our identity as Māori. Derek, thank you for your presentation this evening, and we acknowledge your scholarly contributions and actions that are firmly positioned alongside those of your ancestors as part of the cultural and intellectual continuum of mātauranga Māori in both form and function. We appreciate that you came out of your rua taniwha this evening, and we have been treated to an insight into the taonga you have created. As an institution, we are lucky to have a professor such as Derek. His knowledge can literally, shelter us, protect us, remind us of our past, locate us literally in the earth, be worthy enough to be housed in the Smithsonian, a feature he didn't mention tonight, but I'm telling you, he's got a waka in there, and takes us to the stars and beyond. Not many of us can say that our scholarship, our research is intergalactic, and you really do have to be a taniwha to pull that off. Nō reira, hei whakakapi ake I aku kōrero I tēnei pō, e whitawhita tonu ana te ahi tupua o tīpuna Ahorangi Kawiti. Kia eke ai te kōrero ko Ngāti Hine e ngunguru nei. Kua toto te puna ki tau mārere I o kōrero, I o mātauranga, nō reira, nō mātau te maringa nui I tēnei pō. Loosely translated, tonight we have witnessed the continued flickering of the fires of Professor Kawiti's ancestors, and we have been flooded by his sacred waters of Tau Mārere with his knowledge and his presentation, so that we can say we have certainly felt the presence of his people, Ngāti Hine. Tēnā koutou katoa. I'd now like to invite back to Te Mara to close us with a karakia, and then we're going to invite you all into the common room for some refreshments. Tēnā koutou katoa.
Ko te tapu o ngā kōrero ka pakairia ki ngā pakitara o te whare, kia tūturo o whitu ka maua, kia tīna, haumi e hui e tāi ki e.